I shared with you a couple of times. I used to ignore vitamin K2. I totally ignored it for a long time. Then some viewers asked me to look into it, so I did. I went straight to the clinical trials, and there's just not much on clinical trials on K2 yet. You know, maybe there will be, maybe there won't be. But recently, I got interested yet again in vitamin K2, and I'm going to drop that discussion for just a second and pick up an entirely different thread and see if you start to make the connection here. And again, there may be a significant connection, maybe not. Let me just read some titles. Reduced serum concentrations of carboxylated and undercarboxylated osteocalcin are associated with the risk of developing type 2 diabetes. The next one, osteocalcin is related to enhanced insulin secretion in gestational diabetes. The third one, association between serum osteocalcin and markers of metabolic phenotypes. And when you get deeper into the article, the metabolic phenotypes they're talking about are for mostly insulin resistance, diabetes. So does osteocalcin ring any bells? Let's talk about that in just a minute. But before we do, I mean, there's article after article. Low osteocalcin level is a risk factor for impaired glucose metabolism in a Chinese population. And just over and over and over again. These are not two or three articles that I've just cherry-picked out of the science. There's clearly an implication for glucose metabolism linked to osteocalcin. Now, wait a minute. Does osteocalcin ring any bells yet for you? And to link it back to that first topic I brought up about vitamin K2, remember we were talking about the mechanism. How could vitamin K2 impact both soft tissue like artery walls and hard tissue, bones? Well, it has to do with carboxylation. That's undercarboxylated MGP and undercarboxylated osteocalcin. With MGP, matrix GLA protein, that once you carboxylate MGP, you can inhibit vascular calcification. With the bone, you can increase calcification of the bone by carboxylating osteocalcin, activating it. You can also, what most people don't get into, even the K2 gurus, is that you can go both ways in terms of calcium and bone. It helps to activate both osteoblasts, which build or deposit bone, calcium in bone, and osteoclasts, which cut calcium or protein out of the bone. But again, K2 is very involved in activation of the enzymes, which are involved in turn with managing calcium. So let's go one step further. As I mentioned, that just gives you the topic that I covered just now. Osteoblasts, B, build, and osteoclasts, C, cut. Both of them have very much to do with bone mass. That's how our body continues to customize our bone mass to our current needs. And again, it's MK7 is suppresses on the osteoclast side, and it stimulates on the osteoblast side. So, very interesting, right? But wait a minute, was this about K2 or was this about insulin resistance? So, in humans, osteocalcin levels are inversely correlated with multiple variables of type 2 diabetes, such as glucose intolerance and insulin resistance. Decreased levels of osteocalcin have also been correlated with premature myocardial infarction and coronary heart disease. So here is a graph. Looks kind of scattershot at first, but as you begin to notice, no, you don't have a lot of dots down here and a lot of dots up there. There is a fairly reasonable correlation. What is it? Hemoglobin A1C on the vertical axis and osteocalcin on the horizontal axis. So it's interesting. I haven't heard a lot of discussion about K2 and whether there's any, at the end of the day, whether there's any K2 relationship with insulin resistance. And that's one of the things that's just really intriguing to me right now. But as I said, there's no question that that K2 is related to osteocalcin, and osteocalcin is in turn related to insulin resistance. Here's a visual on it. Osteocalcin increases both adiponectin, adipocytes, fat cells, and proliferation of beta cells, and increased insulin and increased insulin sensitivity, leading to improved glucose handling and lower fat mass. So what's going on here? Heck if I know, but it's a very interesting set of relationships, isn't it? If you've made it this far, thanks for your interest.